Well, our next guest has been at the helm of the New South Wales Rural Fire Service during what has become the worst bushfire season on record, with the tragedy of lives and homes lost. Shane Fitzsimmons has been with the RFS for over three decades, and the Commissioner has kindly taken out a little bit of time to chat with us. It's so good to have you here. Commissioner. Emotional when you walked in, Commissioner, because you have been this constant on our screens during the worst time in Australian history. I've had to give you a hug when you first has anyone asked, how are you?
Oh, look, I'm going along just fine, and it's been an awful year. It's been a very difficult year. When I say year's fire season into 1920, there's just no doubt about that. We've seen some of the most damaging, destructive, tragic fires that we've ever experienced in New South Wales. It's been truly horrible.
I think just so people know, I think I speak for everyone when I say just thank you so much. Your leadership has been exceptional. I've never seen anyone just hold it together in such an unprecedented crisis. The audience, when you just came out during the break, just broke into spontaneous
standing
applause. And I think that is reflective of how the country and the state feel. So thank you very much.
And how does that make you? You seem a bit overwhelmed.
No, it's a bit embarrassing, really. I mean, at the end of the day, I'm doing a job like everybody else, and I'm part of a massive, amazing team that's been operating here in New South Wales. We've got a remarkable team here in the state across all the firefighting agencies, police and emergency services. But this season, we've seen people from all over the country, from New Zealand, from the United States, from Canada, all coming in, integrating really, really well, tying in together just to do their very best for the people of New South Wales. It's quite remarkable.
I got to see some of that up close, and I know a lot of journalists have over this time. We were caught in the Blue Mountains at a time when the road was closed ahead of us and behind us, and 25 RFS trucks arrived, and they came from everywhere. They came from the northern beaches. They came from... they got their briefing, and then I'll never forget this. They all got together for a big group hug before they got in their trucks and then went into this fire that was just beyond description. And I just thought, oh, my God, these people are absolute heroes. And you're in charge of keeping all these people going in what seems to be an endless quest. Mm. Is there any end in sight to this horrific summer?
It has been relentless, Ange, and there is no doubt about it. I think just looking at some figures yesterday, major bushfire emergencies in New South Wales, we're now running at 151 consecutive days this season. And we've got to keep reminding ourselves, well, there's a lot of focus, understandably, down the south coast at the moment. We were averaging more than 1,000 fires a month during winter, June, July, August, up in northern New South Wales. And the damage and destruction through northern New South Wales as the fire season has moved southward, it was quite extraordinary leading up to Christmas. And then in the month or so just before Christmas, we started to see more lightning, more fires, hotter, drier conditions spreading literally from the Queensland border to the Victorian border. And if you look at a map at the moment of the extraordinary area that's burnt out across the Great Dividing Range, just under 5.5 million hectares. It's like a quarter of the Great Dividing Range has been consumed by fire. And you can map burnt out areas. Effectively, there's this contiguous line from Victoria all the way up to the Queensland border. And the fires have consumed whatever's in its path, whether it's beautiful, you know, pristine wildlife corridors, rainforest areas, or where people settle, live and work. It's been quite extraordinary.
I think, but because they have been so severe, they're almost a new kind of monster, as you guys have said, and because they started so early, it's made people really alarmed. There's been a huge political debate. The role of climate change, of course, we know, has been at the top of everyone's mind. Has the political firestorm around these fires made it hard for you to do your job?
Look, I focus on the facts and the reality. I very deliberately don't get involved in the emotional hysteria, and I don't think anyone's benefiting from this frenzied debate from one end of the spectrum to the other. And what we need to do is have sensible dialogue, meaningful dialogue, factual dialogue in the middle. You know, we've got to be focusing. And for an organisation like us, I don't care what your view is on things like climate change, but at the end of the day, we've been factoring in the issues around science and climate change and forecasts for well and truly over a decade. It underpins our business cases, it underpins our planning. We've had good support from successive governments investing record amounts in things that matter, So the science for us, to simplify it down, talks about longer, hotter fire seasons. It talks about more frequent, more intense fire weather events. That means a shrinking window of opportunity for hazard reduction burning and prescribed burning. It also talks about things like overlapping fire seasons between us here in the Northern Hemisphere. And we've seen that. But over the last decade or so, particularly since I've been the commissioner, we've had really good support from government. We've got record investment in mitigation programs and teams to help us take advantage of shrinking windows of opportunities, more technology and more equipment to help us burn out larger areas in shorter windows of time. We've seen things like major procurement around a large air tanker, because we know hiring them in competition with the Northern Hemisphere was proving difficult. And thank goodness that arrived here in July and hasn't stopped since. And we've got five of them in New South Wales this year, which is unprecedented. So we've been factoring in the implications of longer, hotter fire season. And then you add this year in and you look at the effect of drought. We cannot overstate the criticality of the drought situation with 100% of the state drought affected. Yep. The only good thing in a drought from a fire risk point of view that we've seen in this last couple of years is that there's nothing burnt to burn in far western New South Wales. Mm. But you get to the Great Dividing Range, back end of the mountains, all the way across the top, right out to the coast. You've got forested country, you've got rainforests, you've got all sorts of pristine wilderness that are so ridiculously dry. Fires are starting so easily and spreading extremely quickly, and that's what we're seeing.
And you know that backburning isn't without risk as well. You lost your dad during a pretty standard backburning exercise.
Yeah, that's right. So hazard reduction burning, or the prescribed burning, back in the 8th of June 2000, Dad was working with National Parks at the time, doing a really important hazard reduction burn up in the northern suburbs of Sydney, Ku-ring-gai, and tragically, three people died that day on a small mountain, burning in the back of communities, and another fellow died a couple of months later from the injuries he sustained, and three survived with extraordinary injuries as a result of being overrun by fire that day. So hazard reductions are not without risk, they're not without consequence, and I'm very dismissive of people that just say, oh, we should just get out there and light up the bush, because it's a load of rubbish. And there are very real risks involved for those that are actually executing the burning strategy, but there's also implications, and you've only got to go back a couple of months. We've got all these people screaming for more now. We've only got to go back a couple of months, and we were enemy number one, because we were burning around Sydney, we were burning around New South Wales, and smoke is a byproduct of combustion. You can't have burning without smoke, and then people complain about smoke, but we're also mindful that there are health implications from smoke as well. So we're not ignorant to that fact. Mm. But
weren't you getting calls from people saying, oh, you know, there are embers that have burnt holes through my shade cloth and things
after,
like that?
After every burn, we get claims for replacing trampolines, sun tuff on the roofs. So people complain and lodge claims financially against us every time we do burn. So it is complicated.
Can I ask this personally, Shane, did losing your dad make you think twice about becoming a firefighter yourself?
It did. So I was a volunteer from when I was 15, so I followed my old man into the organisation, and I've grown up effectively in the organisation, which is why I love it so much. I love what people do, why they do it and how they do it. But there's no doubt when that accident happened back in June of 2000, I did think for a while, if something like that can happen to my old man with all those decades of experience, then I've got to give this game away. But the thought didn't last too long, because I'm also a big believer. You can have everyone on the sideline criticising and pontificating and all that sort of thing about what should happen. Yep. But if you really want to see change, you've got to be part of the process. And I think in a way it probably strengthened my resolve to get in and invest very heavily to do all that we can to avoid loss of life, you know, going forward.
We have had loss of life this season though from within your team. Mm. How hard has it been for you to be with their families after that? And you've been such a comfort to them, but how hard has it been for you?
Oh, there's no doubt it's the toughest, most difficult thing I've done, I think, in my career and in my time with the organisation. But also I think it's one of the most important things. Yep. And as I said to some of the team that we've been talking recently, there's no script written for this sort of stuff, fortunately. Mm. But you do have to work with instincts, and I know I've always believed that leaders, no matter what level you are in the organisation, when things are going wrong, when things are tough, I think that's when you've got to be present and accountable most. And being able to spend time with the loved ones in their darkest of hours is difficult, but it's also, dare I say it, very precious and very sacred that people will let you into a space of such grief and such trauma and share with you thoughts and feelings. And for that, I will always be forever grateful, and it'll stick in my mind forever.
Commissioner, the photo of you with little Harvey Keaton, for me, that this was the photo of the summer. Oh, it just makes me want to burst into tears. It was such a special moment. What was that moment like? for you?
I don't know.
As a father yourself?
It was, and I spoke to Jess, the mum, before that. There was no plan to do that. It just happened. This young fella was right next to us. He was moving around and sitting there with that little dummy in his mouth. It just epitomised the gravity of loss and grief that we were dealing with. And being able to present Jess and Harvey in that case, and then later Mel and Charlotte, and of course when we saw Sam pass away, Megan, the partner, to be able to present them with Commissioner's commendation for service and Commissioner's commendations for bravery, it's critical that those young ones growing up, that those wives, that those families know that these extraordinary individuals, these extraordinary men, their husbands, their dads, they didn't leave, they didn't walk out, they left this world as absolute heroes, committing their time, committing their service so selflessly, for the want of nothing in return, nothing in return at all, other than to make a difference in their community, and tragically, they paid the ultimate price. So in some way, I sincerely hope that those special commendations sit with the family and sit with those young ones, particularly growing up, knowing that their dads were absolute heroes.
Yeah. Well, you've been such an emotional support, actually for the entire nation in a way. Tell me about your support system. Who's looking after you?
Look, I'm surrounded by wonderful people in the office and across the organisation, through government.
Your beautiful family there.
That's what it's about, eh?
Yeah, absolutely. And No. It's all right, it's all right. They're really good. No, look, my family keeps me very, very grounded, and my wife's an absolute rock, and my daughters, they're pretty good.
Yeah.
You've honestly been, I don't know how you do it, we're all cheering.
It's all good.
You've been the most extraordinary leader in a time where we needed leadership, and you gave it to us.
And if I can, you know, there is a little story that I can tell, and I met my wife when I was a volunteer, and her dad was the local fire control officer, and growing up back then, there was no mobile phones or anything like that. It was all tied to radios and after hours. And I remember a few challenges there where she said to her parents, "I'm never getting involved with anyone in this bloody organisation. it just consumes your life and takes up so much time." And they do remind her about that now. But there's absolutely no doubt when I get home, everything is just absolutely grounded. I'm in charge of nothing. I can't say no to her. So the only thing I've got responsibility is to load the dishwasher. And I can say that in those darkest of moments where I struggle, ringing my wife is one of the most important things I do. And absolutely, shedding a few tears here and there and talking through what's happening, I'm blessed to have three wonderful women in my life at home. So.
We're blessed to have you. Yeah.
If you didn't love him before, you are going to adore him now. Hey, really quick, because I know this has gone on and on and on, but I'm going to ask you, very, very quickly, lots of people were saying you're prime minister material during your time. Ever thought about a tilt in politics?
Oh, I don't think so. And look, I think it's really sad what we do to our politicians, and I just don't think I'm cut out for that sort of that sort of thing. And I think Lisa would leave me if it came to that.
You're just a beautiful man, a great leader. Shane Fitzsimmons, everyone.